Thank you. When Anshal was 8, she left her small village and arrived at Varanasi Seventh-day Adventist School. She had no friends, she didn't respect the teachers, and she knew nothing about Jesus. Anshal moved into the dormitory and quickly began making friends. The dorm is a social place where students play games, relax, and do schoolwork. Many of the students spend time reading their Bibles. This was a totally different world to Anshal's previous life in the village, but she found herself enjoying Bible studies and trying to get good grades. Eventually, Anshal gave her heart to Jesus and is so grateful for her experience at the school.
Really, God has blessed me so much that I learned so many stories and so many activities in this church, and I like them so much. And my favorite story is Joe.
Like Anshal, many students come to this school knowing nothing about Jesus, but their lives are transformed. They are immersed in a holistic learning experience. In addition to the standard subjects, students learn about health, engage in fun activities, and enjoy delicious meals. Each Sabbath, students attend the Adventist House of Prayer, located right on campus. They often participate in the Sabbath program. Anshal and her friends love to sing for the congregation.
We are having these children from the village area, and they are learning Jesus, and they know that this is all blessing coming in the name of Jesus to them and to their families. So that's how the message of love and Jesus is going to the rural area from this small school.
God has blessed this school with more and more students each year, but unfortunately, the dormitories are over full. The girls are crammed into a small space with bunk beds piled up against each other. This quarter, a portion of your 13 Sabbath offering will help expand the girls' dormitory, allowing more girls to attend school.
Present, we have only one room and we have 25 girls here. But then when the dorms are there, we will have around 60 girls in the dormitories. We will have just the double or triple of the girls studying in this. In this way, we will be educating more students in our school.
Please pray for Varanasi Seventh-day Adventist School. Pray that the teachers and students can continue to be a positive light for each other, like they were to Anshal. Please consider what you can do to help the girls at this school. Thank you for supporting projects such as this.
Thank you for supporting Mission Offering.
For joining us at Margate SDA. We welcome you to our church, and we are glad to have you here with us. We're honored to share this day with you as we worship God's risen Son. We hope that God touches your life as we worship together, and that you leave this place with the peace of God. We will now go into our children's story.
Stories of the Bible. Jesus turns water into wine. This is Jesus.
Heyo!
Who is the Son of God and the Savior of the world. Jesus was born in Bethlehem and grew up in Nazareth, where he grew in wisdom and favor with God.
Oh, I see.
And man. One day, Jesus, his disciples, and his mother went to a wedding in Cana. In the middle of the party, the wine ran out.
Uh-oh.
So Jesus' mother, Mary, told him, "They have no more wine."
Aww.
Jesus replied, "Dear woman, that's not our problem. My time has not yet come."
Excuse me.
But Mary told the servants, "Do whatever he tells you." Standing nearby were 6 stone water jars. The Jews used jars like these in their washing ceremony. Jesus told the servants, "Fill the jars with water."
Yeah, okay.
When the jars had been filled, he said, "Now dip some out and take it to the master of ceremonies. So the servants did what Jesus told them to. When the master of ceremonies tasted the water that was now wine, not knowing where it had come from, though of course the servants knew, he called the bridegroom over. A host always serves the best wine first. Then, when everyone has had a lot to drink, he brings out the less expensive wine. But you have kept the best until now. This miraculous sign in Cana in Galilee was the first time Jesus revealed his glory, and his disciples believed in him.
Dear Lord, you are the way, the truth, and the light. Help us to walk in your example so that when others see us, they see you in us. Teach us to be role models in our speech, thoughts, and our faith. Whatever we do, help us to do it for your glory. In your name we pray, amen.
Happy Sabbath, Margate. God is good, and all the time God is good. We're going to do our opening hymn at this time, number 367, Rescue the Perishing.
Rescue the perishing, care for the dying, snatch them in pity from sin and the grave. Weep o'er the erring one, lift up the fallen, tell them of Jesus the mighty to save. Rescue the perishing, care for the dying, Jesus is merciful, Jesus will save. Though they are slighting him, waiting the penitent child to receive. Plead with them earnestly, plead with them gently. He will forgive if they only believe.
Everybody,
rescue the perishing, care for the dying. Jesus is merciful, Jesus will save.
Our last verse.
Rescue the perishing, duty demanded, strength for thy labor the Lord will provide. Back to the narrow way, patiently win them, tell the poor wanderer, a Savior
has died. Rescue!
Rescue the perishing, care for the dying, Jesus is merciful, Jesus will save.
Our scripture is taken from Luke 10, verse 25. That's Luke 10, verse 25. And behold, a certain lawyer stood up and tested him, saying, Master, what shall I do to inherit eternal life? He said unto him, What is written in the law? How readest thou? And he answering said, Thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, and with all thy soul, and with all thy strength, and with all thy mind, and thy neighbor as thyself. And he said unto him, Thou hast answered right. This do, and thou shalt live. But he, wanting to justify himself, said unto Jesus, And who is my neighbor? And Jesus answering said, A certain man went down from Jerusalem to Jericho, and fell among thieves, who stripped him of his raiment, and wounded him, and departed, leaving him half dead. And by chance there came down a certain priest that way, and when he saw him, he passed by on the other side. And likewise a Levite, when he was at the place, came and looked on him and passed by on the other side. But a certain Samaritan, as he journeyed, came to where he was, and when he saw him, he had compassion on him. And he went to him and bound up his wounds, pouring on oil and wine. And he set him on his own beast and brought him to an inn and took care of him. And on the morrow when he departed, he took out 2 pence and gave them to the host and said unto him, take care of him, and whatsoever thou spendest more, when I come again, I will repay thee. Which now of these 3, thinkest thou, was neighbor unto him that fell among the thieves? And he said, he that showed mercy on him. Then Jesus said unto him, go and do thou likewise.
Happy Sabbath, church. At this time, I just would like to give a friendly reminder of our offering. These times are uncertain right now in many avenues. Our giving doesn't have to be, and the good Lord has provided multiple avenues for us to participate in this thing. We have our website and give our offering, and the conference has a website where we can return our tithes to the Lord. So while everything is maybe in disarray, let us understand that we can still consistently give and return to the Lord what is His. And also, it is time for prayer. I'm asking that those at home, please find a quiet place if you can, where you can concentrate as we come to the foot of the cross.
There is a stillness in the atmosphere.
Let us pray. Heavenly Father, Lord, we thank you for so much, for your consistent ways, Father. As we toil and labor throughout the week and fulfill our own personal agendas, often putting you to the side, dear Lord, you always find a way to hover your Holy Spirit over us on a daily basis, dear Father. If we only knew the tragedies that we avoid every day, thinking that it is our own merit, dear God. We're so selfish, dear Father, and I thank you for the agape love that you display on a regular basis. You who can just speak anything into existence and in the same breath take away that which you have created, dear Lord. Bless each and every life that is here right now, dear Father. Week after week, I am amazed at the level of production of each and every individual that comes together as one to tell themselves that your word will be displayed to the rest of the world, dear Lord. Thank you for this technology that you have bestowed upon us, dear Father. Those in remote locations, those in countries that I can't even pronounce, can just click a link and see your word being delivered to them, dear Father. Oh God, thank you so much, dear Lord. Help us to not take this for granted, dear Father. This is a great luxury that we are utilizing, but unfortunately, there will come a day where it may be stripped of us, dear Lord. But Father, I pray that that resilience, that fire, that zeal may never be stripped from us to do your will, dear Lord. Father, we come to you heavy burdened, dear Lord. This is a great time of uncertainty when we should be relying on the leaders of this world to display a level of decorum and confidence, dear Lord. There just seems to be too much uncertainty, too much dismay. Help us to hold our heads high and look towards you, to continue to give us that zeal, to continue to give us that confidence, although the ship may be sinking, dear Lord. Oh God, each and every individual that is here, you know them by name. You know the hairs that are on their heads, dear Lord. You know the type of crosses that they've carried to this edifice, dear Father. A lot of the times we walk by and we see a smiling face and we think that all is well with them, dear Lord. But only you, inside their heart of hearts, know what it is that they're dealing with on a daily basis, dear Father. Right now I petition those in a lesser circumstance, dear Lord. Those that are in the third world countries, dear Lord. Those that don't have clean running water. Those that don't have the resources that we have over here, the luxuries that we take for granted on a daily basis. I'm petitioning them to you right now, dear Father, that you will be a comforter unto them and provide them with every need that they have. They're crying out to you, dear Lord. Let us not forsake them, dear Father. Oh God, thank you so much. Lord, we are here today to continue to move your word forward. And there is a speaker here today, Father. I pray that you hide him in the cleft of the rock, dear Lord. Hover your Holy Spirit. Put a hedge around him so that the enemy may not thwart his thoughts or confuse him, that his words may flow crystal clear, dear Lord, to all of those seeking to hear you today. Dear Father, thank you for bringing him here safely, dear Lord. Oh God, hide him behind the cross. Each and every individual that is here doing, taking part in this program, help them to understand that this is a great work that we are doing, dear Lord. Thank you so much for everything, dear Father. I pray that we leave here more filled than how we came, so that we can be a blessing unto others. Be that lighthouse in the night that they may see, that points to you, dear God. Thank you once more for everything. And please, please forgive us of all of our many sins. This I do pray in your most righteous and holy name. Amen.
He is here. He's here. He is here. To break the yoke. To break.
In the prayer, we have a servant of the Lord here to deliver God's message. He hails from Plantation Seventh-day Adventist Church, and it is none other than Elder Ahkeem Darden, who I hear is a wonderful singer as well. But today, he is here to deliver God's word. But before he comes, we have another mouthpiece of the Lord to do our special song, Brother Kevin Clark. So whisper a prayer for him as he comes to deliver a message in song. And after that, we will hear from Elder Darden.
Happy Sabbath, everyone. Happy Sabbath. God is to be praised. Hallelujah. We serve a living God that promised he will never leave us nor forsake us. And it's that same God that sent his only son to die on that cross. I can't experience a love like that. I don't think none of us could ever experience a love like that. I hope the next two songs that I present to you paints a picture in your heart.
introduce to you. In this corner of the good and the right stands a champion robed in white. His height exceeds the heavens. His weight outweighs the world. His reach reaches everywhere. His age is evermore. And he is higher than the highest, greater than the great. No one will ever take his crown away. He's more mighty than the mightiest, and he reigns from above. Undefeated champion of love. He left his hometown to enter this arena, to wave his hand in victory for me. An angry crowd crucified this king who wore the crown, as they gladly watched my champion going down. But I will never count him out, for I'm a witness of the day he arose to retain that title, champion of love. And he is higher than the highest. He is greater than the great. No one will ever take God's crown away. He's more mighty than the mightiest, and he reigns from above. He is higher than the highest. He is greater. He is more mighty than the mightiest, and he reigns from above. He is the all-time undisputed, undefeated champion. The all-time undisputed, undefeated champion. The all-time undisputed, undefeated champion of love, of love.
And he's the all-time undisputed, undefeated champion of love.
Peace like a river. soul. It is well, it is well with my soul. My sin, oh, the bliss of this glory.
Testing, amen. Whew, what a powerful, powerful song. Thank you so much for setting the stage so that the word of God can go forth. Thank you so much for your ministry. Sometimes you have to say it is well in the middle of circumstances where it just doesn't feel like it's well. And so I thank you so much for that testimony that when things seem like it's just falling apart, sometimes I'm just going to have to say it is well. It is well with my soul. And so today, I just want to just thank you for inviting me here today. I want to thank you for the opportunity to share the gospel of Jesus Christ. And today I have a message that has been pressing on my heart. And I believe that now is the time to hear what God has to say about this very important subject. I believe that we're in a very special and unique time. There is a global pandemic. It's claiming the lives of hundreds of thousands of people here in the United States. There's civil unrest. There is There is the exhaust of the machine of systemic oppression that just hangs in the air as so many of our brothers and sisters seem to be run over by our society. And in the middle of all of that, sometimes we've got to say it's well. In the middle of all of this strife and turmoil, there's something else that's going on. You see, the rich seem to be getting richer and the poor seem to be getting poorer. What is tearing down one group of people somehow is benefiting those of others. According to a recent report from the Institute of Policy Studies, America's billionaires saw their wealth shoot up by $288 billion in just 23 days of the shelter in place. 23 days, billionaires saw an amazing increase in their wealth. Their wealth grew by 10% in the same time, while 20 million people filed for unemployment. And so I want us to understand that, yes, there are things that are happening. But we've got to be careful that we pay attention to a group of people that God has a unique relationship with, that I want us to spend some time today just talking about and bringing to our attention. You see, the poor are getting overlooked. The widow, the orphan, the oppressed. God has a very special relationship with them. He's calling us in the middle of everything that is going on to pay very special attention to this group of people that can be overlooked. God says that He loves this group of people. I began to search the scriptures and I began to see that this relationship that God has with this group of poor, widow, orphan is something that we got to pay attention to, because it's all throughout His word. He's saying, hey, I got a special relationship with them. You should pay attention with them. If we look at Deuteronomy 10 and verse 18, let me see if I can get this going here. Are we going to see if we can make this work out? We're going to point it in which direction? Point it over here. All right. There we go. Oh. So why don't you just, I'm going to put this down. I'll just tell you. All right. For us to understand how God thinks about this group of people, I dug into His word and I began to search the scripture and I began to run into a consistent theme. Deuteronomy 10 and verse 18, He defends the cause of the fatherless and the widow, and He loves the alien, giving him food and clothing. Psalms 9 and verse 18, but the needy will not always be forgotten, nor the hope of the afflicted ever perish. Psalms 14 and verse 6 says, the evildoers frustrates the plan of the poor, but the Lord is their refuge. Go on to the next one. We're going to speak to this verse. I need us to pay attention. This one right here. This verse right here. Think about this within the context of what's going on and listen to this one. Woe to those who make unjust laws, to those who issue oppressive decrees to deprive the poor of their rights and withhold justice from the oppressed of my people, making widows their prey and robbing the fatherless. And God goes on to say, what will you do on the day of reckoning when disaster comes from afar? To whom will you run for help when COVID is knocking on your door? Where will you leave your riches? Nothing will remain but to cringe among the captives or fall away slain. Yet for all of this, His anger is not turned away. His hand is still raised. God is saying in this, and I want you to understand this, and we can go through the many, many, many more verses that support this relationship that God has with those who can't speak up for themselves. He's saying, I'm listening to them. What you do to them, you do to me. I'm paying attention. They can't speak up, but I'm listening. I'm their refuge. And not only is He saying, I'm listening to them, but He's saying, structure your life differently so that you are relevant to them. Let's go to the next slide. The Bible says, structure your life so that you are relevant to this special group of people. What do you mean by that? In Leviticus 19 and verse 10, Leviticus 19 and verse 10, the Bible, God instructs the children of Israel. He says, hey, listen, I know you have your agrarian society, your farmers, but here's what I want you to do. I want you to not go over your vineyard a second time or pick up the grapes that have fallen. Leave them for the poor and the alien. I am the Lord your God. Oh, okay. Don't clean up. Don't pick up all of it. Leave some for the poor. All right. Okay. When you reap the harvest, don't reap the very edges or gather of your field or gather the gleanings of your harvest. Leave them for the poor and for the alien. I am the Lord your God. Okay. So don't clean it all up. Don't harvest around the edges. Leave it for the poor and for the alien. Go to the next verse. It gets even better. At the end of every 3 years, bring all of the tithes that were going to go into the storehouse. Come on, y'all know this. It was supposed to go into the storehouse, but no. 3 years, I want you to bring all the produce and store it in your towns so that the Levites, aliens, fathered widows. Come on, are we detecting a pattern here? Who live in your towns may come and eat and be satisfied. And during the seventh year, let the land lie unplowed and unused. Then the poor among you may get food from it, and the wild animals may eat what they leave. Do the same with your vineyards, your olive groves. James 1 and verse 27 says, the pure and undefiled religion in the sight of God the Father is this, to visit the orphans, the widows in their distress. God is saying, listen, structure your life so that you're relevant to the poor. You see, if we were to translate this to today's society, right? So they were farmers, right? And God said, listen, around the edges of your farm and what you do, I want you to give back. I don't want you to take everything. Make sure in your daily life, I want you to be relevant to the poor. He didn't say, instead of your tithes and offerings, give to the poor. He didn't say that. You still bring your tithes and your offerings to the storehouse. But he's saying, in addition to that, as you go about your normal life, make provisions for the poor. So how does that translate to us today? All right, well, I give my tithes, I give my offerings, but I'm not a farmer. I work for Amazon. Okay, well, how do I make myself relevant to the poor? Well, I go to my boss and I say, hey, listen, I'm a part of a church that's very active in the community. What can you do as Amazon to help partner with me to meet the needs of the poor so that in my daily life, I am actively working to be relevant to this special group of people? If you're a doctor, if you're a nurse, the point of this is whatever your vocation is, find the edges of it. Don't go back through and make sure that you are relevant to the poor, the widow, and the orphan in your vocation. Make your life relevant to those. This is a dramatic departure from what we typically think it means to be there for the widow, the orphan, and the oppressed. We think, well, we just give some money, some folks will take care of it, and that's it. But God says, no, I want you to do things a little bit differently. I want you to make your life relevant to the poor. Okay. All right. I get it. I understand that they're special to you, that you want my life to be changed and to be relevant to them. Help me understand how to do that, God. I'm not there today. Help me understand how. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, Lord, we come before you understanding our deficiency, understanding that we are the poor when it comes to needing your mercy and your grace. And you have so freely bestowed it upon us. While we were yet sinners, you died for us. And so God, we thank you and we praise you and we ask that as we continue to explore your word, that you will send your Holy Spirit to shine a light and that it will, that your word will sink down deep and spring forth to new life and changed hearts in Jesus' name. Let everybody say amen. Amen. How many of us in here are Seventh-day Adventists? Okay, we got one or two online. Anybody there? Seventh Day. Just raise your hand wherever you are. You're Seventh Day. One of the unique things about being a Seventh Day Adventist. See, I didn't grow up Seventh Day Adventist. I grew up Pentecostal. Don't hold that against me, please, please. listen, I've been known to shout and to do a praise dance back a long time ago. You know that. But I came to the faith. I came to the faith, and some interesting things that I learned about the Seventh Day Adventist Church. You see, at a very high level, the Seventh Day Adventist Church, we believe that the church is comprised of those who truly believe in Christ. Okay? But in the last days, come on, somebody say last days. The last days, a time of widespread apostasy is coming. And a remnant has been called to keep the commandments of God through the faith of Jesus. See, this is what makes us unique, right? This remnant announces the arrival of the judgment hour, proclaims salvation through Christ, and heralds his second coming. This proclamation is symbolized by the three angels in Revelation 14. Can I get an amen, church? There's a part that I just want to call out really quickly. We, a remnant, has been called to keep the commandments of God. Can I get an amen? See, we're known for that, right? We're known for keeping the commandments. There are others who are trying to change the commandments, but we are known for keeping the commandment. Every believer has a responsibility for keeping that commandment. And I'm a bit of a math person. I began to think about this keeping the commandments and loving your neighbor and this oppressed, and I began to put it all together. It's like a beautiful mind when you have all these things popping out. I'm reading the word, and all these scriptures are happening. I'm beginning to see, and God began to clarify for me an interesting relationship between loving God, keeping his commandments, and the poor. And it's like this. Romans 13, verse 8 through 10, is sort of the crux of this. Let no debt remain outstanding except the continuing debt of love to another, for one another, for whoever loves others has fulfilled the law. The commandment, you shall not commit adultery, you shall not murder, you shall not steal, you shall not covet. Whatever other command there may be is summed up in this one command, love your neighbor as yourself. Love is the fulfillment of the law. Okay, God. Okay, I'm working with you here. Fulfillment. If I'm going to keep, if I'm known, my church is known for keeping the commandments. Keep the commandments. And the Bible says all of the commandments are summed up in one command, love your neighbor. Loving your neighbor must be pretty important to us as Adventists. Yeah. Right? Because the Bible makes it clear. Yeah. If we are holding and we are following the commandment, and we're unique because we follow the commandments, and the sum of it is love God and love your neighbor, then this loving your neighbor thing should be pretty important to us. And that brings us to Luke chapter 10, verse 25 through 37, which was the scripture reading for the day. You see, the Pharisee, and you know what? Let's read that. Let's really quickly, let's read, and I do not have it down, and I'm going to read it directly from the Word of God. A scribe, a lawyer, comes to Jesus and asks the question, what must I do to inherit eternal life? In verse 25 and verse 26, he says, amen, there you go, there you go. Jesus turns around and says in verse 26, what's written in the law? How do you read it? How readest thou? He answered, Lord, love the Lord your God with all your heart, all your soul, with all your strength, with all your mind, and thy neighbor as thyself. And he said unto him, thou hast answered right, this do, and thou shalt live. Keep going. But he wanting to justify himself, we're going to circle back to that one, said unto Jesus, who is my neighbor? And Jesus answered, a certain man went down from Jerusalem to Jericho, fell among thieves who stripped him of his raiment and wounded him and departed, leaving him half dead. And by chance there came down a certain priest that way, and when he saw him, he walked on to the other side. And likewise a Levite, when he was in that place, came by, looked on him, and passed on the other side. But a certain Samaritan, as he journeyed, came to where he was, and when he saw him, he had compassion on him, and went to him, bound up his wounds, pouring on oil and wine, set him on his own beast, brought him to an inn, and took care of him. And on the morrow, when he departed, stayed with him the whole night. Come on now. Stayed with him the whole night. And then the following day, he took out 2 pence, gave them to him, and said, take care of him. Whatever thou spendest more, I will come again and repay thee. Now, which of these three, thinkest thou, was the neighbor unto him that fell among the thieves? And he said, he that showed mercy on him. Then Jesus said unto him, go and do likewise. I believe this lawyer was trying to trip up Jesus. I believe that just like they often did, he went to justify himself, wanting to make Jesus look bad, wanted to see if he can concoct a scenario that makes him look good and make Jesus look bad. But Jesus turned the tables on him. And he comes up to Jesus and he says, hey, what must I do to inherit eternal life? I believe that inherent in that question is the answer. I want you to think about this for a second. In order to inherit eternal life, if you're going to get an inheritance, is it about what you do or is it about who you are? You see, if I have a son, my inheritance goes to my son because he's a part of my family. It's not what random people do to me or for me that determines the inheritance. The inheritance comes because you're a part of my family. And so this scribe comes to Jesus and asks this oxymoronic question, what must I do to inherit eternal life? And Jesus recognizes, no, you got this all off, brother. But let me figure out where your head is. And he says, you tell me. And he comes back to that principle that we talked about a little bit earlier, love God and love your neighbor. And Jesus says, all right, I see where you are. This is what we're going to do with you. I'm going to tell you a parable. And he begins to tell them this parable. I believe that Jesus does some amazing things in this parable. He could have simply said in this parable to this scribe, he could have said, there was a man who was who got robbed and was on the brink of death. And there was a gentleman who walked on the side and ignored him. And another one walked by and ignored him. But there was a special somebody who stopped, who dressed his wound, and that is his neighbor. That could have been the extent of the parable. But Jesus didn't leave it like that. Knowing where the scribe was, knowing that he was a part of a church system, he used the church system to indict his lack of empathy toward his neighbor. You see, he seemed to have this thing of loving God down, right? Because he didn't ask. When Jesus said, what are you supposed to do? He was fine saying, love God. But then he said, who is my neighbor? You got to understand that the stakes are pretty high in here, what he's asking about. He's saying eternal life. What must I do to inherit eternal life? And Jesus says, the word of God says, love God and love your neighbor. He feels like, I'm fine on the loving God part. I need you to hear me here. He believes he's fine on the loving God part, but needs some clarification on the loving your neighbor part. Because listen, if I got the first part down, and if I can refine who I understand my neighbor to be, then I can lock up this eternal life business. I already love God. But if I can find out, if I can clarify, if I can narrow down, if I can get to, listen, my neighbor are the people that are within five miles from me, plus my cousins and my nephews, then I'm good. And so seeking to create a loophole, to refine who don't I have to love, I need you to hear me. His question really was, who don't I have to love? And Jesus says, oh, I see what you're saying. Let me tell you this story. And he tells a story about not just a guy walking by, but the church walking by. Remember, he's a scribe. He knows the law. He's a part of the religious system. So Jesus confronts him right where he is with what he understands to let him know, listen, I'm about to change everything about what you understand of who is a neighbor. So a Levite walks by. Now a Levite, you know, those are the praisers, right? These are the people that are in the sanctuary, the high priest. These are the highest people in Judaic society. These are the people that are actually supposed to help. And Jesus uses them as an indictment to him of who's not helping. Listen, I believe our church, I love our church. I think there are opportunities for us to be more relevant to those around us. I believe that like the Pharisees, we can know the law. We can know the law but miss out on the heart of God. That Pharisee and that scribe knew the law inside and out but still didn't understand how to love his neighbor. And I believe the church of God can easily fall into that trap today, where we've got the truth and we know the truth. But we find ourselves distant from being the hands and feet of Jesus. I know it's easy for us to nod in affirmation and then say yes, but I'm going to tell you, I've been convicted that I haven't done what I needed to do. I can preach and tell other people to do it, but I know that I've been found wanting. I remember I was the worship director at Plantation, and I was headed to church, and I was leading out in worship, and I was late, or I was in the process of being late. And a lot like today, I was driving a little bit too fast to get here on time. And as I was going down the road, I noticed there was an old man, who started to walk out in the middle of the road. And he had his walker. And he stepped out. And he stepped out in the middle of oncoming traffic. And I thought to myself, I need to stop and guide this man across the street, because if I do not, this man will not make it. But then at the same time, I thought, there's about 1,000 people waiting for me at church. And the night before rehearsal, I'm telling them, listen, if you don't get to church on time, it's a reflection of your prioritization of all things spiritual. If you don't get to church on time, it's a reflection of your sin-sick condition. Yes, so I need you to make sure that you prioritize Jesus in your life. Get up and get to church on time. And I find myself now at a crossroads, literally. And this old man needs my help. I'm sad to tell you that I got to church on time. It's easy for us to shake our head and say, you know what, the church should be there. But when push comes to shove and you are asked to be inconvenienced and you're asked to risk your money, your time, your stature, being late, giving sacrificially, do we really do that? I believe that you get compassion and mercy from the people that you least expect it sometimes. Sometimes when you're going through the situation, you expect church members to be around you, and sometimes the world pulls up faster and more complete than your church family who you thought was going to be there for you. It is sad. Just the other day, God's working on me on this. I'm headed down. You know, God has already convicted me. You need to be more. You need to be active. And I decide, you know what? I'm going to go down to Fort Lauderdale with my church, and we're going to feed the homeless, and we're going to pass out provisions. And we do it every 2 weeks. And so I was supposed to head down, but I had the sermon to get prepared for. And so my wife says, "Hey, we got this thing. Are you coming?" And I say, "No, I can't go because I have to prepare a sermon. I'm writing a sermon." Y'all, church, follow me here. I'm writing a sermon about Levites walking past those who need us and making a decision to not go. So, church, is easy. It's easy to sit there and say, "Hey, meet the needs, be inconvenience." It's another thing, and I understand it. I believe that two of the most powerful verses in the Bible reflect sort of this, the reason why we find ourselves in this situation. It's not on the screen, but John 8 and verse 58 gives some clarity as to why sometimes we find ourselves in this situation where we're not relevant. Jesus is talking to the Pharisees and Sadducees, and he's telling them, "Hey, I am," he says in verse 58, "I tell you the truth, before Abraham was born, I am." Two most powerful verses in the Bible, I believe, are verse 58 and verse 59. The two most powerful verses in all of the text. For me, I'm not a theologian, this is just me personally. When Jesus declares that I am, he is declaring his divinity. And because of his divinity, he can be the perfect sacrifice. And because he's the perfect sacrifice, I can be right before God as I accept him as my Savior. My right standing before God is determined and is because Jesus is the I am. And so it's powerful when he says, "Listen, I am the I am." It means something to me when Jesus says, "I am the I am." Because the assurance of my soul's salvation, knowing that I'm going to meet my father again who passed away, is because Jesus is the I am. Powerful. But we're followed with one of the saddest verses in all of the Bible. One of the most powerful verses is followed by one of the saddest verses in all of the Bible. Verse 59, "And at this, they picked up stones to stone him. But Jesus hid himself. He went out of the temple, going through the midst of them, and so passed by." I need you to understand what just happened here. Jesus, the object of our worship, in his house, had to leave because the people were going to stone him. In his house, the object of our worship, we kicked out because we don't understand the nature of our Savior. You see, this is why the scribe can ask, "Who is my neighbor?" Because he's kicked Jesus out of the temple. And we can find ourselves in a position where we don't understand the heart of God because the temple of my heart does not contain Jesus. Gandhi said, I like your Christ, but I despise your Christians. You see, Christ was fine, but Christ doesn't live in y'all. You're more known for telling us what not to do. You're more known for telling us this is what I eat and what I don't eat than being relevant to those who are reflecting the heart of God. Are you known, church? Are we known by our love? the world looks at us quizzically as we declare that Jesus is God. They're like, oh yeah, that's interesting. I'm hurting right now. Where are you? And then here's the next part of this. Jesus, not only does he layer in the concept of the church being irrelevant, but he does something very interesting. He takes it to the next level, and he introduces race and tribalism into this parable. See, it wasn't just anybody who helped. It was this half-breed Samaritan. And my wife, I was explaining what I'm going to be preaching on. She says, well, hon, why do they call it the Good Samaritan? Why do they need to specify that the Samaritan is good? Why isn't it just the Samaritan? And the reason why is because according to the Jews, no good, no compassion can come from that Samaritan. So they need to specify the Good Samaritan, as opposed to the regular Samaritans. See, they believed that no compassion, no good, nothing of quality can come from that race. And listen, God worked with me on this one too. God confronted me on the intersection between race and the needy and who is my neighbor. I remember, listen, just coming here today, there was a man on the corner. White man. Y'all, hold on, church, bear with me here. Bear with me. See, I'm about to say some things. I know I'm new. I need y'all to love me regardless. Can we? All right, so here was my issue. If I saw a white man, young white man on the corner asking for money, see, this is where race intersects, right? I mean, if I saw a young, able-bodied white man on the corner, I had a hard time opening up my wallet because my thought process was, listen, you have zero instructional impediments to your success. You have won the lottery to be male, young, white in the United States. You, whether you believe it or not, benefit from a system that simultaneously gives you all the benefits and takes them away from me, not just me, but extracted it from my forefathers and terrifies my son today. And I got to open up my wallet. I got to open up my wallet and give it to you. You wouldn't. Before God worked on me, no, you ain't getting a dime. But God is working on me. God worked on me, and He said, listen. You don't determine who the least of these is. That is not you to determine that person is in need and that person is not in need. And He really confronted me. He shook me down. And He said, listen, whatever you do to the least of these, you do unto me. You don't know what that man has gone through. That man could have mental illness. He could be struggling with addiction. His daddy and his daddy's daddy was struggling with alcoholism. You have no idea what got him to the least of these. Confront this, Ahkeem, and get that racism out of your heart. Ooh, that hurt. And so I was like, all right, God, I get you. A couple of weeks later, I'm coming home from visiting a customer, And I pull into a gas station. I see a young man sitting at the door near the gas station. And it's a white young man. I say, there you go, God. Look, just like that, you're going to put me right to the test. Able-bodied young white man just chilling with his cup. So I go inside. I'm like, you know what, Lord, I'm going to do this. And I went and I make sure I get enough change. I get a $5 bill, y'all. I'm going big time for Jesus, y'all. I walk out and I go to put that money in that cup. He looks at me, he's like, what are you doing? And I was like, oh, I thought you kind of needed the... He's like, no. And I realize after getting closer, upon closer inspection, he's got a skateboard, he's got a little backpack on. He's just taking a quick break, enjoying some refreshment, and here I am in my judgmentalism. In my judgmentalism, deciding I'm going to take care of this poor white man in need. listen, there's never a time that I've preached on this subject that somebody comes to me afterward and says, yeah, but does God really want me to give even though they're going to hop into a BMW and they don't really need it? I mean, but what about the people that are just doing drugs? Does God want me to give them and be relevant to them? Isn't there a point in which God is saying, hey, wait a minute, cut it, and don't do for the least of these? No matter how clear the word of God is that says, for the least of you, what you do unto them, you do, no matter what it is, there's always an excuse. There's always a loophole for us to rationalize why we don't do what God tells us to do. And so I find myself saying, all right, God, you got me. Matthew 25, verse 41 through 46. Hopefully I put that in there. There you go. I think you got a back one. We need to understand that this is not just a matter of giving to the poor. This is not just a matter of following the commandment of God. This is a little bit deeper than that. And Matthew 25, verse 41 through 46 puts this in the right context so we understand the serious nature of this. I talked about it anecdotally, but listen exactly to what God says here. Then he says to those on his left, depart from me into the eternal fire prepared for the devil and his angels. Think back for a second to the lawyer who asked, how do I gain eternal life? I want you to, we're just wrapping it all together now. Listen, he says, depart from me into the eternal fire prepared for the devil and his angels. For I was what? I was hungry, and you gave me no food. I was thirsty, and you gave me no drink. I was a stranger. You did not welcome me. I was naked. You didn't clothe me. I was sick and in prison, and you didn't visit me. And they will also answer, saying, Lord, when did we see you hungry or thirsty or a stranger or naked and sick or in prison and didn't minister to you? Then he will answer them, saying, truly I say unto you, as you did not do it to one of the least of these, you did not do it to me. And these will go into eternal punishment, but the righteousness into eternal life. Have you read that verse within this context? What you do for the least. So God is being clear. Hey, I'm separating the sheep and the goats. I'm separating who gets eternal life and who doesn't. And he's saying, I'm making that separation based off of what you did to the least of these. I just want to make sure we understand this. And I want you to think about your life in the lens of what God just described here. I'm separating eternal life based off of what you've done for the least of these. I want you to understand that every time you encounter someone who is in need, family member, church brother and sister, somebody out in the corner, every time you meet someone in need, it is a divine interaction. Because he says, he doesn't say what you do for them is like what you do for me. No, he says literally, what you do to them is what you do to me. So when you look at that person and you see them, you translate what you see or who you see, transpose and see Jesus there, and you understand what Jesus is trying to tell you. You don't see a white man there. You don't see a person on welfare. You don't see somebody who might take that money and get inside of a BMW. No. You don't see any of that. They are the people that least deserve it. Guess what? That's who God has called you to be relevant to. It's a divine interaction, and you meet Jesus every time you interact with a person in need. And I just want to solidify this before we close with just a few more verses that helps shape this perspective. James 2 and verse 16 says, go and If somebody tells you, hey, go in peace, stay warm, be well fed, and doesn't provide for his physical needs, what good is that? In the same way, faith by itself, if it's not accompanied by action, is dead. How many times have you gotten off the phone with somebody and they tell you, well, I'm praying for you. Well, I just told you I got kicked out of my house and I don't know where I'm going to go and I don't know where the rent's going to come from. We're going to lift you up in prayer, sister. The Bible says, wait a minute. If you just say, all right, we pray for you, what good are you doing? Deuteronomy 15 and verse 9 said, if there's any poor among your fellow Israelites in any of the towns of the land the Lord your God has given you, do not be disheartened or tight-fisted. Rather, be open-handed and lend freely to them whatever they need. They may appeal the Lord against you, and you will be found guilty of sin. What? Guilty? Give generously to them and do so without a grudging heart. Then because of this, the Lord your God will bless you in all your work and everything you put your hand to. Does anybody need God to intervene on their behalf? Anybody struggling and need God to show up? Listen, my relationships are not where they need to be. My job is not where, my body is racked with pain. My wife, my kids, my life is not where it needs to be. God is giving you a clear relationship between him moving on your behalf, blessing you, and what you do for others. Back to the question, what must I do to inherit eternal life? I just want to make sure we're clear that people can do good things. And if you listen to the sermon and your response is, well, I promise I'm going to do more good things, then we've missed the point. You see, it's about being a part of the family of God. It's about being changed. It's about understanding that God died for me when I was yet in sin. And because of the outpouring of his love and mercy, because I'm transformed in the newness of life, because his grace is sufficient for me, it's going to pour out of me on to those who are around me. You see, Jesus, when he described that neighbor to the scribe, he said, listen, this is not about who is your neighbor. This is about you being neighborly. And because you have the essence of being a neighbor, anyone around you is now your neighbor. See, this is the difference between doing good and having a life that's transformed by the goodness and graciousness of Jesus and having that pour out all over those around you. That's what motivates you to good works. That's what motivates. And if you don't do it, you have to ask your question, am I changed? Am I really a part of that kingdom because my actions don't reflect it? I believe that there are two types of responders to those who are in need. I think there are crime scene investigators. And when you think of crime scene investigators, when they get on the scene, when they roll up on the man who's been beaten half of his life, they come in and they find out, why is he in this position? Who did he make upset? What was the angle of the cart that came in to hit him? We've got to figure out what was wrong. See, crime scene investigators are responsible figuring out why. And too many of ourselves as Christians find ourselves, as we are confronted with those in need, becoming crime scene investigators. But God is calling us to be first responders. God is calling us to be first responders. You see, when first responders show up on the scene, they don't care why. They don't ask questions, how did you get there? They simply administer care. They simply meet the needs. They pour oil and wine, and they give of their money, and they give freely of their time to help those who are in need. God is saying enough, enough of the crime scene investigators. As you determine who's worthy and who's not worthy, you put yourself in the position of knowing the heart of those people. And there's only one person who knows the heart. And that's Jesus. And when you get in the position of saying, well, that person deserves it and that person doesn't, and that person deserves it, it's a quiet form of idolatry. Because now you are sitting and saying, you, yes, you, no. And so God is saying, listen, I don't know where you are. I don't know if your life is typified by what you do for the least of these, but I'm asking you today to become a first responder.
We want to thank Elder Ahkeem for such a timely message. We ought to be each other's neighbors, correct?
Amen.
Amen. So we're going to close off with our closing hymn, number 327, I'd Rather Have Jesus Than Silver or Gold. Sing along with us as we conclude our Sabbath today.
Father, we just thank you. We thank you for the proclamation that we would rather have you than hold on to what can be corrupted. We'd rather have you than money, houses, land, and cars. And God, For that statement, some of us will need to pray that in faith, because it is not indicative of the way that we live our lives. And so help us to understand that our time is short here on this earth, that the fields are truly white, and that we have to be about the business of your kingdom, starting with the least of these. And so, God, fill us with your presence. Fill us with your love. Convict us of where we have fallen short. Help us to find ourselves at your feet, asking for the refilling, for the outpouring, for the overflow of the Holy Spirit to change our lives, to break us and to make us and to mold us into something unrecognizable by the world. And make us ambassadors for your upside-down kingdom. This is our prayer in Jesus' name. Amen and amen.